this is something that may seem awkward, but we're going to take about 5 minutes to be in silence, be in reflection, be in prayer. I know this might be something that seems awkward to us to just sit in silence for 5 minutes, and honestly, I am accusing myself too, but it's kind of sad that we can't do that without thinking it's awkward. In a society where we're so distracted, whether it's by music, by our phones, by the internet, by TV shows, anything, you know, that takes up our time, that distracts us from reflection that could be had otherwise. So if we could, Josh, if we could get the lights down a bit, you guys are welcome to sit or come to the altars and kneel, and just reflect on what God might be telling you this morning, and or you can, pray for one another or somebody in your life that you know that needs it. So let's just spend the next few minutes in silence and just listen to what God has to tell you. reflection and prayer. If you want to sing, you're welcome to sing along, sit, stand, come to the altars. Just however the Spirit is moving you this morning, or wanting to move you, let it happen. And just enjoy the reflection. Take this mountain weight and take these ocean tears. Hold me through the trial. Come like hope again, even when the fire seems lost, I'll praise you. Even when it hurts so bad, I'll praise you. Even when it makes no sense to sing louder than I'll sing your praise. Oh, I will only sing your praise. Oh, I'll only sing your praise. Oh God, I will only sing your praise. I will only sing your praise. is done louder than I sing your praise. I will only sing your praise.
Let's pray. Healer, our Prince of Peace. Lord, no matter what happens in our lives, what we might be going through, no matter if there's pain because of this mortal bodies or pain in our spirits, we will keep going and keep singing your praise. Lord, we're here because we love you. We're here because no matter what the world might throw at us, we will praise you. Lord, in this moment, we give to you, we lift up to you all the requests of this congregation. Every single need, every single thing that might be making someone anxious or nervous, preoccupied, worried, we give to you, Lord God, anything that might just be disturbing our minds right now. And Lord, in this moment, we invite your Holy Spirit to be in the midst of us and take control of everything that happens here. And may you be, Holy Spirit, the one that's healing everyone here. So that everybody, everyone here might feel your manifestation as they encounter you today. Lord, we put to you and we give to you the message this morning and every other single time that we'll be having in this service. And Lord, we give our lives to you and we declare that we give you all the glory and the praise, and that we're here to give you glory and praise and encounter you in a more deep way. We pray all this in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit of God. Amen.
Good morning. I'd like to welcome you to our service today. We're all glad that you're here. A small weather change from last week to this week, so what are we going to do about it? At least the fall time is here. Jeff's coming forward, and he's passing out the black booklets that we just asked that you sign and either pass to the next person or set it down on the chair beside you. But as he comes and does that, and we take the offering, let me pray for our offerings this morning. Dear Jesus, once again, we are just so glad to be here, so thankful for the things that you do for us. And may you just bless our tithes and offerings today. Whether it's us personally or us as a church, it's just sometimes astonishing about how well you take care of us and the ways that you provide. We just love to see it work in those things. So we just ask that you continue to let us be good stewards, both personally and corporately. And we lift this up in your name. Amen. As they pass the baskets today, I want to remind you, you can always give online here at the church. Also, I want to remind you that we do prayer groups every week, and on Tuesday nights at 7 for 1 hour, we pray for the needs of the church here, and it's corporately for everybody. At 6 o'clock on Wednesdays, we do a prayer for lost, or we pray for our families and our neighbors and our coworkers who may not know Jesus, and we pray for those on a weekly basis and keep lists and things like that, so it's really good. This is October, and Halloween is coming, and the church does what we call a monster mash here, where Pastor Mickey gets all kinds of games and things for the neighbors to come to the church on trick-or-treat night, and she's looking for candy and small prizes to be dropped off here at the church so that we can help out and be part of that. And I just want to encourage you to drop off some trick-or-treat candy here. It's a great outreach for our church for specifically our neighborhood who comes through and enjoys being here at the church on trick-or-treat night.
Good morning. There is one more announcement. It is for our teen fall retreat. It's actually this coming weekend, so it'll be Friday the 19th through Sunday the 21st. It costs $50, and you just need that and a medical release form to go. And basically, fall retreat is one of our big events we do with the teens, where we just kind of get away from the chaos of life, and we get to go and just be together and grow closer to one another and grow closer to God through worship, through a speaker and time of devotion, and also through like night glow games and dodgeball, because it's youth group, you know, we have to do glow games and dodgeball. So anyway, if you have questions about that, please talk to me about it. You can sign up all this week, and there are forms out on the youth ministry table that you can grab to tell you more details, as well as a packing list of what to bring. So from there, cue the Disney clip. Never mind. We don't have a Disney clip. So we'll go ahead and dive in then. If I forgot to mention it, my name is Morgan. I'm the youth pastor here. And right now we're in the middle of a series called The Bible as Told by Disney, which is why we have the little Disney castle and all of that. And today's movie is probably one of my favorite Disney movies of all time. It's Beauty and the Beast. So who here has seen Beauty and the Beast? Good. Okay. So if you've seen it, tell me. I know there are like four-ish main characters, but who would you say the top three main characters are? Belle, that's one. Beast, that's two. Gaston, yeah. Those are the exact three I was going to use. So to give you a quick recap with those three characters, the movie begins with a selfish prince who's cursed to become a beast unless he learns to love and is loved in return. He has hope for this curse being lifted when Belle, a young maiden, offers to take her father's place as a prisoner in Beast Castle. Belle sees good in Beast and actually begins to fall in love with Beast. But outside of the castle, there's Gaston. He is the conceited, egotistical hunter who thinks he's awesome, and he wants to win the love of Belle, but he also hates Beast, and so he makes it his mission to both kill Beast and quote-unquote save Belle. That's his goal. And the movie kind of grows intense as Beast is just starting to learn to love and be loved, but time is running out before his curse is permanent. And as time is running out, Gaston is getting closer and closer to the castle, again to kill Beast and save Belle. So it's a great movie. If you haven't seen it, you should definitely watch it. But in the movie, there are three main themes that, in my opinion, make Beauty and the Beast one of the best movies. Number one, and you can, like, raise your hand if you agree with me, okay? We'll make this interactive. Number one, you can't help but cheer for Beast. Does anybody else feel that way? Like, you root for Beast the whole movie. Number two, there are two opposite views of Beast that are competing throughout the whole movie. Belle sees him as good, she loves him, but Gaston sees him as evil and hates him. Who else would say, yeah, that's a main theme, that makes the movie good? Yeah, three people, okay. And last but not least, the most classic Disney theme of all, love is the most powerful force, and it can transform even the worst of beasts. And then you say, aw, because it's true, because they fall in love. Well, anyway, those are, in my opinion, the three things that make Beauty and the Beast just an awesome, awesome movie, and reasons why I love it. But each of these three, I think, also go along with some deep scriptural truths. To talk about that, I've kind of divided the sermon today into two parts. So we have part one and part two, just to keep it simple. And we'll go ahead and dive into the first part. The first part has to do with that first theme, that we can't help but root for Beast, right? But I think that's because in some way or another, we can all relate to Beast, because he's living with the consequences of his cold heart. He gets cursed because he messed up, and now he's kind of living in this cursed reality. Now, our story isn't that dramatic. We didn't, like, as a kid, lie to our parent and then suddenly grow fangs and fur and become a beast and say, like, oh, I'm cursed and I have this rose that tells me how long I have to learn to love. But we all do have a bit of a curse in our story, that we all began as these created beings, as humans, made to be in relationship with God, to love and be loved by God and to love one another, but God gave us free will to choose to love him back or not, and we chose to do our own thing. We chose to sin. This was Adam and Eve in the garden in the very beginning, and once they sinned, they brought about this new brokenness of reality where things just weren't as God intended, because that's what sin does. It ruins what God intended things to be like. And so they kind of ushered in this broken and fallen world, and we've all experienced the hurt of that, or the reality of that, and each of us in our own has sinned. And Paul talks about this in Titus, in the book of Titus. He says, "At one time we too were foolish, disobedient, deceived, and enslaved by all kinds of passions and pleasures. We lived in malice and envy, being hated and hating one another." See, Paul points out that we've all been there. We've all been slaves to sin at one point. In other words, we've all been the beast. We've all been foolish and selfish and hateful, living for pleasure, living for our own thing. We've all been there. But this is where I think maybe we go wrong as Christians. For some reason, we always start at that point. We start with, we're sinful humans, and we pretend that that's the beginning of the story and the beginning of our created identity, when the reality is, there was a whole part of the story before sin ever entered, where God created humans and said, "Whoa, this is very good," right? Like, he creates birds and rocks and all these other things, and he said, "That's good, that's good, that's good." And then he creates humans, and he says, "This is very good. It's not just good, it's very good." And so here we're created to be very good, and we're created to be image bearers of God. Or you may have heard the term imago Dei, which means image of God. So we could say imago Dei or image of God. They mean the same thing. But that is our first truth as humans. Our first truth isn't, I'm messed up, sinful, and broken. Our truth before we ever sinned and were messed up or broken is, we were made to be good and to be image bearers of God. And with that, there's also this worth that comes with our being because we're made in God's image and we're image bearers. Kind of like if you picture, who here is a mom or a dad? I can't raise my hand. Okay, moms and dads, would you say that you really do take delight when your kid has a trait that's yours, that you recognize, you're like, oh my gosh, that's like a little bit of me in them. I passed on a part of me to my kid. Unless it's like one of your not better parts, then you're like, they got that from the other parent. That's not from me. But that's kind of how I picture God is with us, where we are so beloved and valuable that he passed on his likeness to us, that we are children of God. Again, that gives us this worth and this value that we cut out of the story when we talk about being sin bearers instead of image bearers. See, I think, who here has heard the song, "I'm Only Human"? It's like, "I'm only human." You know the song? I don't know any other words except for that part, but I know that it talks about being human. And I know that a lot of times when we think of being human, we mean, I'm forgetful, or I'm human as in I mess up, I'm not perfect, I'm prone to do bad, or I'm prone to do evil. That's usually what we mean when we say I'm only human, instead of I'm good innately, and I'm valuable and worthy innately. Instead, we use it kind of like an excuse. Like, well, what do you expect? I'm only human. In other words, why do you expect me to be or do good? Because I'm only human. See, the first part of our message, the first point of it, is that like the beast, we're not innately bad, and we're not innately evil or worthless. Beast, before he ever became the beast, he was a prince. He was a human, and he did mess up. See, like that, we are created to be image bearers of God, to be loved as his very children, but kind of like the beast, we also kind of messed up. We have all sinned. Now, the next thing Paul says after the part about us, you know, being enslaved to sin and that part is, but when the kindness and love of God our Savior appeared, he saved us. Not because of righteous things we had done, but because of his mercy. Not because of righteous things, whoa, but because of his mercy. God wants us to know that today. It's not because of the righteous things we've done, because it's double in there. But he saved us through the washing and rebirth and renewal of his Holy Spirit, which he poured out generously through Jesus Christ, our Savior, so that having been justified by his grace, we might become heirs, having the hope of eternal life. So in other words, even though we sinned, And even though we took this image of God that we were meant to bear and we broke it a little bit, God still sent his son to save us, to forgive us, to make a relationship possible again. But the most beautiful part, I think there are a couple beautiful parts of this, is that he didn't send Jesus Christ for the people who seem good enough or seem like they're worthy of that love, but he sent Jesus for the people who are like the worst of beasts. If you picture beasts in the beginning of the movie, he's pretty bad. Like, he has a temper. He yells at Belle. He has her as a prisoner. Like, he does not start the movie well. But for us, when we were all there, when we were all enslaved to sin, God sent Christ even when we were at our worst. And even better yet, when we accept Christ, when we repent and believe in Christ and the work that he does, there's another part of this story. In the verse, it talks about renewal. Specifically in verse 5, it says that we are reborn and renewed by the Holy Spirit. Now, when I looked up definitions or descriptions for these words, reborn and renewed, the term that kind of kept coming up was renovation, to better understand it. And when I thought of renovation, my first thought was, oh, a home renovation, because I'm a girl and I'm on Pinterest, and I like looking at before and after pictures of home renovations. So if you can see this, when we think renovation, we think there's this before, then voila, there's this beautiful after, the bus moves out of the way and you see this beautiful picture. Same with the inside, it's filled with junk and it's like this gross basement, and then voila, we have this beautiful downstairs entertainment center. You know, that's kind of what renovation is. And if you've seen HGTV enough times or been on Pinterest or Google, you're familiar with the before and after and just the surprising difference between the two. See, renovation, this idea of renovation, when we're talking about rebirth and renewal of the Holy Spirit, it's not just like coming into a house to paint some cabinets or putting up a new window or putting up a new picture. But renovation, rather, is, okay, we have this shell of a house that has stuff inside. We're going to start moving out the junk. We're going to knock down some walls. We're going to rip up the carpet. We're going to redo everything, right? That's what renovation is. It's not redecorating. It's renovating, as in gutting the house, putting something completely new in there instead. Admittedly, I've never built a house or renovated or owned a house, so in my mind, that is renovation. But we're kind of like that. When we accept Jesus and we start following him, it doesn't end there. But instead, this work of renovation begins as soon as we repent and believe in Jesus. That means that the Holy Spirit, first off, we receive the Holy Spirit when we accept Christ. It's not like he's there, then not there, then there, then not there. We have the Holy Spirit when we accept Christ. And what the Holy Spirit is doing is the Holy Spirit is renovating our hearts. And so he comes in, he's starting to take out the junk, that ugliness, the meanness, the sin, the stuff that's in our heart that's kind of messed up. He's taking that out. He's knocking out walls, tearing up the carpeting of our heart, all of that. And the Holy Spirit starts getting rid of all these things that were in our hearts, and then once that's all gone, starts building something new in there. But instead of building new rooms, instead of, putting in new floors and all of that, the Holy Spirit's putting in a new heart that is sensitive to God, a new spirit, new character, new thoughts, new behaviors, new tendencies. The Holy Spirit is building a new us. And what that new us is a restored image of God. In other words, we were meant to bear the image of God. That's kind of the first thing we talked about. What does that mean, though? The image of God is an image of love. The God isn't, he's not just loving. He doesn't have love as a quality, but by his very being, his very nature is love. God is love. And so when we're image bearers of God, that means we're love bearers. And that's what the Holy Spirit is making in us, is these people who are living, walking love, like love with skin on. Bob Goff says that. That's not my own thought. But that's what the Holy Spirit is doing. And so before we move any farther or into the second part of the sermon, I wonder a couple things. The one is kind of like we already talked about. Do you really believe that, like the beast, you personally are not bad, you're not worthless or hopeless, but rather you were created to be an image bearer of God, valued and loved as his very child, even though you have sinned and broken this image that you were meant to bear. But two, again, Christ comes, he offers forgiveness of sins, Without hesitation, he offers the Holy Spirit to make us new. And so I wonder for us, have we stopped letting the Holy Spirit make us new or renovate us? Have we stopped working with what the Holy Spirit is doing in our lives? Or do we recognize that day to day we are being made new and we are growing? See, I think with this, has anybody here ever tried to work out for like a week or longer or tried to get in shape? Anytime you start getting in shape, Julian Michaels yelled this at me from a yoga video one time when I was trying to get in shape. And she said, you have to get comfortable being uncomfortable. And I was like, I'm sorry, Julian. I'm really like sweaty and gross and my body hurts. And if you've tried to work out, you know how uncomfortable it is. Like how much your body that is not in motion likes to stay not in motion when it's there. That's kind of how growth is. We have to get comfortable being uncomfortable as Christians. We should be comfortable, or we shouldn't be comfortable, because that means we're complacent. We're not growing. We're not becoming more and more and more like Christ every day. Rather, God's intention for us is that we would grow to the very last day of our lives, and that every single day there's something new that he's forming in us, a new work, a new attitude, a new something in us. And that's what I wonder, essentially, with that second point, is are we still growing, or have we kind of stopped, and are we comfortable with where we are? Because God desires to do so, so much more in our hearts and in our lives. Now, for the second part of the message, there are two main themes that kind of work together from the movie. The first one is the opposite views of beasts that are competing throughout the movie. That Belle views Beast with love. She thinks he's good, whereas Gaston views Beast as a monster and hates him. So we have love and hate, we have good and we have bad. And then the other theme, again, the classic Disney, love is the most powerful force and can transform even the worst of beasts. Now, while these points, to me at least, seem really classic Disney and kind of cliche Disney, they're also really, really deeply spiritual, I think. So let's begin with that second point. Love can transform even the worst of beasts. Who here has heard of the story of Paul, Saul to Paul? Okay, cool. So in Acts 9, that whole chapter tells the story, so if you haven't read it, I encourage you to go home and read it because it's awesome. But Paul starts out as Saul, and his life starts off with him pursuing Christians, killing Christians, stoning them, taking captive women, children, men, anybody who proclaimed to be a follower of Christ. And he was on his way to the high priest to get permission to arrest, again, any man, woman, or child who professed to be a follower of Christ. His intention, most likely torture, or most likely some form of killing them for proclaiming to be followers of Christ. But when he was on his way to get permission, he was going as Saul. The Lord, you know, called Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And he was blinded and he was stopped and he was knocked down. And at this point in his journey, he went from Saul to Paul, where God invited him to a better life and invited him to stop persecuting him. And then after this point, he goes through a huge change, where instead of persecuting the church, he became a main core component of the church and a leader of the church and a person who kind of built and led the early church. See, Paul is actually the one who wrote what we just read out of. So full circle moment, what we just read, Paul, who used to be one of the worst beasts, he was a murderer and a killer, God transformed him by his love and called him to be a part of something different. The love of God can transform even the worst of beasts. This is something I think if we proclaim to be followers of Christ, we have this optimistic hope that no person, no matter how awful or mean or rude or nasty or hateful, they can be transformed by the love of Christ. That is what our scripture tells us, is that if someone like Saul, who was a murderer, can become Paul, who ended up being murdered for his faith, man, what more can God do with people that in our minds seem like the beasts, who are mean and selfish and nasty? The love of God transforms people. That is what he's in the business of doing. And if we are followers of Christ, we hold tight to that and we believe that. The second main theme of the movie, it was again that competing theme of how Belle and Gaston viewed beasts differently. Gaston saw him with, there's Belle. Belle saw him with love. She has love in her eyes. You can tell they're twinkly. Whereas Gaston, he saw him as evil and he hated him. He was also all about himself. So those are our two characters. But for us, what that kind of means, what that translates into scripturally, is how do we see other people? I know when we begin following Christ, we still struggle. We don't talk about it a lot in the church, but I recognize when we start following Christ, we don't instantly have no problems or no struggle with sin or anything. It's a process, and we grow. We grow more over time, but we're not instantly there. And in that struggle, I think one of the things that we struggle maybe the most with is how we view other people, that we have this tendency to see other people as sin bearers first before they're image bearers. In other words, we see them more like Gaston than like Belle. We have an easier time not liking someone than we do loving someone. What I'm asking is, for you, do you see others as image bearers of God or as sin bearers first? And like I said, I think for each of us, we could grow in that area. You see, if we're Christ followers, if we proclaim to be that, our walk with Christ doesn't end when we accept forgiveness. Like I said earlier, there's this renovation happening throughout our whole lives, but it's leading up to something. We're being renovated for a purpose. And this purpose is called a lot of things. You could call it holiness, Christian perfection, sanctification, Christian maturity, a lot of these big words. They all kind of mean the same thing, though. Basically, they mean being perfect as God is perfect. Jesus invites us in the Gospels to be perfect, therefore, as God is perfect. Now, the problem, though, that we have with this language, and I want to use the language of perfection and Christian perfection, because I think we hear perfect and we hear Christian perfection, and red flags start shooting up in our minds, because what we start thinking is, oh, perfection means I have to do exactly all the right things and exactly none of the wrong things. We think of the term legalism, that it's about all these little rules that aren't as important, or we think that it's this impossible life that we couldn't possibly do, so we don't even strive for it. In our culture and in our time, the word perfection has kind of been marred, even though it really was intended to be a very good word. Well, I want to talk about that. And with it, Thomas Aquinas was a theologian from the Middle Ages who, in my mind, perfectly explains that word perfection. What he did was he took Aristotle's philosophy and he took it to explain Christian perfection. So what he did, he said that perfection, this is what Aristotle thought, is the fulfillment of something's created purpose. That is what perfection is. What that means is this chair has a purpose, right? What's the chair's purpose? To sit in. Yeah. The chair's purpose is for me to be able to sit in it and for it to hold me without wobbling or breaking. It would be really funny if this chair somehow broke quickly, but seeing that it doesn't, this chair is holding me. It's not breaking or wobbling. Therefore, this chair is perfectly fulfilling its created purpose. Therefore, this chair is perfect, because it's fulfilling its created purpose. Now, on the opposite side, a lot of us have been really frustrated by the things that have one purpose, and they don't seem to do their one purpose well. Or we see pictures of them and we laugh. For example, here are some pictures of things that are supposed to fulfill their purpose. Like this phone that floats on water. Look at it fulfilling its purpose. Or the next one, nothing like going to the bathroom for some privacy, right? Like these doors giving you good privacy. Or the next one, a bench with lots of leg room and a good view. We can go ahead. Or a calculator whose job is to tell you what two numbers added together equal. Or the next one. Or there's nothing like eating soup or cereal with your nice slotted spoon. That will work well. Or the Top Care toothbrush. The irony of this is the fact that it's called Top Care, and it only has one bristle in it. It has one job. The next one. Or signs that tell you what to do, like to please slow drively. Or the next one. This is the last one and one of my favorites, Chico's Mexican Restaurant, which fulfills its Mexican restaurant purpose by having the best pizza in town. I'm not going to lie. I had way, way, way too much fun looking at these pictures when I was preparing for today. But all that to say, perfection is fulfilling created purpose. So all those pictures we saw were things that are not perfect. They have one created job and they weren't doing that. Whereas this chair fulfilled its created purpose by holding me. So if we apply that to humans have a created purpose. When we are created, Thomas Aquinas said that our scripturally based creation or created purpose points to loving God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and loving others as ourselves. So in other words, our human purpose is to love God and love other people. That's how we bear God's image. It's an image of love. So I wanted to share this idea with you as fulfilling our created purpose, because I think when we think of Christian perfection or growing in Christian holiness or these different things that Scripture calls us to, it invites us to, we think of kind of the wrong types of things. I think most often we think of growing in our faith or growing in Christian perfection as sin management instead of loving God and others. Now, the difference between the two is sin management is we're focused on trying to not sin. Our focus is on trying to walk this clear line of what I should do and shouldn't do. But when we're living that way, our focus is on ourselves and our sins and our efforts. And by our own doing and our own efforts, we can't rid ourselves of sin on our own. And we also can't force ourselves to become this new and renovated person on our own. But instead, if we look at perfection or growth as loving God and others, it's a little bit different. You see, I think if our focus is on loving God and loving others as we love God and as we spend time with him and grow in our love of him and being loved by him, he will take care of that sin nature in us. That's not our role, but rather that's one of the things the Holy Spirit, when he's renovating, he clears out that sin nature. Our job is to love God and to draw near to God. Our other job, our other created purpose, is to love other people. See, as we do those two things, as we seek to be perfect, as in if we seek to love God and love others, we will grow away from our sin and away from that beastliness that we could have, and we grow more to be what we are meant to be. See, I think this way of perfection also implies a lot of how we view other people. Again, I talked about how there's this difference between Belle and Gaston, how they viewed Beast. And I think for us, if we know that our measure of faith is loving God and other people, then that means like our second measure of faith or of what we're called to do, our second created purpose is to love people, then that means we're called to be a Belle or we're called to see others with love and to love them, even when they act like Beast and when they're awful and nasty, rather than to be a Gaston. Which, by the way, in the movie, Gaston thought that he was, like, perfect. He thought that he did everything right, but he was the least full of love in the whole movie. I wanted to talk about this today because I know that a lot of this can sound kind of like a cheesy Disney truth or something, and a lot of this sounds like, I know, love God, love others. I've heard that before. But I wanted to talk about it as kind of a pause in our life and a moment to step back and to look at the one most important measure we have of our faith, that for each of us, our most important purpose or our most important aspect of our faith is loving God and loving other people. It's not all these other things that we make it about. It produces other things, but our main focus should be on loving God and loving other people. And what I worry about and what I find myself falling into is I make faith about so many other things. About I need to do all the right things, I need to like give money to the right places and do all these things, and then it becomes this legalistic perfection instead of loving God and loving other people. See, what I want to invite us into in closing the message, I want to invite us into being more of a Belle, into seeing others with love. And I want to invite us into stepping back and thinking, okay, if my one most important measure of faith is loving God and loving other people, if that is my most important call that I have in my whole entire life, my created purpose is to love God and love other people, how am I doing at that? If it's really the number one priority of our faith, do we actually go home and spend time with the Lord? Do we actually view other people with love and seek to love them? Again, this is the most important part of our faith, is loving God and loving other people. That's what it's about, and that's what matters. And I think this matters so much, and I want this to be an invitation as well as a call to action as we close. Not only do I want to invite you to go home and look at, you know, how is your faith prioritized? Is it about loving God and other people? But I want to call you to action. I want to call you, each of us to love God and love other people, because there are so many people that we meet and that we know and that live that are like beasts and that are like Paul, who right now they might not be great. They're living in the brokenness of this world and the fallenness of this world, and we see that in them. And you know what? God put us right where we are, around the people that we are, whatever context we are, because his love, the love of God, can transform even the worst of people. And so from here, I want to invite you to be a part of that. I want to invite you to go and to seek to love God and to seek to love people. And as you seek to love other people, I am so confident that you will go and you will see people and see their lives transformed, just like Saul and Paul and just like Beast, because that's what God's in the work of doing. Our role in that and our purpose is simply to love people, to love God first and to love people. That's what we get to do, to see that transformation happen. So I want to challenge you. What does your faith look like right now? What is it about? Is it really about loving God and loving people? That's what matters. So you are dismissed. And again, I challenge you to go from here full of love and to be love with skin on.
My weakest moment, I see you shaking your head in disgrace. I can read the disappointment written all over your face. Here come those whispers in my ear saying, who do you think you are?